guys doing? Supposed to be watching the show.
Coming to get you, Barbara.
This time on Graveyard Cars, Will moves the Daytona into the booth to lay down its final primer.
This is the first Daytona I've actually worked on.
Mark pays a visit to George to assess his metalwork on the 69 CUDA 383 4-speed.
That looks really good. Thank you.
Then Will gets a big surprise when Mark takes over his paint booth to move a project ahead of the queue.
There's no notes. I'm not sure what exactly he wants done.
And Mark works with Alyssa to show her the ropes on a car the ghouls rarely see, a 1972 Tawny Gold Duster in Springfield, Oregon. Mark Warman, together with his skilled ghouls,
it has been established that the unburied dead are coming back to life.
Bring classic Mopar muscle cars back from the dead to look like they did the moment they left the factory floor.
Because of the obvious threat, this station will remain on the air day and night.
Just got the Daytona back from our body man. Got the body work done from start to finish. I primed it, gave it back to him. He blocked it out, fixed a few imperfections. It's in the booth right now, and I have our second coat of primer going on it. Then from that point forward, the car is mine, and we'll be getting it ready for paint. This is the first Daytona I've actually worked on, and the cool thing with this car, it was a running, driving car. It was an original Survivor, and those are hard to find. But it's a cool car, and I'm excited to do it. When you're working with such a great car, the process goes that much quicker. I'll have this over in assembly here in the next couple months. All right, I hope everybody's ready for a fun week. Got a lot going on as usual. Now, my main man, Will, my Toucan Sam, my can of Spam, my green eggs and ham, going to do the final primer and block on our 1969 Charger Daytona. It was a borderline Survivor, so we had a debate over whether we restore it or don't restore it. We opted, for the right reasons, to restore the car. Will has done a primer and block twice on it. This is his final primer. Very exciting, because I cannot wait to put that car back together. The guy's been waiting a long time. He bought it brand new. And just one of the neatest cars at the shop right now. So George down in the body shop is getting ready to put the quarter panels on our 1969 CUDA Fastback. Now this is a real CUDA A body. It's the very first ones they came out with. I need to work with George on that and make sure that he does, looks for the things that I have done in the past that he has not, because I've done them and he hasn't. I'm gonna go at it with kind of a military approach, because I believe sometimes to get a message across, you have to be a little bit stern. And George is receptive to that. But one of the cars that we've got is our 1972 Duster. This is a really cool car. We're ready to install the drivetrain in it. One of the problems is Will keeps saying, I don't have time to paint the rear end housing. I don't have time to paint the rear end housing. So I'm just gonna squeeze it in there and Will's gonna have to deal with it. Because as soon as he's done with that, we can put the drivetrain in it. Alyssa and I want to work on putting the grill, the side markers, the headlights, some of that front end stuff on the car, mostly because she hasn't worked on an A-body either. We only have a few around there. Over in the machine assembly area, we're working on the steering column for that 72 Duster. And lastly, one of my main goals is if I can get Will to paint the rear end for the 72 Duster, then I want to get together with Justin and Doug and round up all of the drivetrain and get it installed in that car. As soon as it's installed, as you all know, we can lower it down, put the wheels and the tires on it, and now it's a mobile car. So then we can roll it forward and start putting the interior in it. So in a perfect world, that's gonna be our week. And I wanna wish me luck. You might have noticed that I've lost some weight, but not all of it. And I'm going to go to meet my favorite morning morsel of food. All right. They love it when I come in here in the mornings. You know, they're all pretty young, so they get excited. Oh, there's TV stars here, you know.
Good morning, McDonald's, how can I help you?
Usual.
All right, what would that be, sir?
It's Mark, Mark from Graveyard Cars.
I'm sorry, sir, that game didn't ring the bell, and that's
Gonna have the 2 for $5 sausage egg McMuffin. Okay. And a large Diet Coke.
All right, thank you.
Yeah. So George has been working really hard on the 69 CUDA 383 four-speed car. Right now, he wants me to come out and sign off on the welding work he's done on the right quarter. Okay. Doesn't look like that quarter moved at all. Good job. You still got a really nice wide line there. That looks really good.
Thank you.
I had looked at it a few days ago to make sure that the quarter was where it needed to be before they welded it on. So he's finished with the welding. I'm gonna mark that off. And then if that's good, I'll go ahead and tell him to put the left quarter panel on. The door fits good. Spot welds look beautiful there. This still needs to be ground down.
I just gotta grab the belt sander, just haven't got to it.
This looks really nice. Yeah, you're getting it down there, Georgie.
Thank you.
Once you get that ground down, I wanna spot blast all that.
Okay.
No more going over anything that's not just beautiful virgin metal. Nice job. Look at those spot welds. Oh, George, you're getting the hang of it. Starting to come together. Yeah. Same thing here. Looks really good. Nice trough there. That'll fill nice. But again, what are we going to do before we put our panel bond adhesive down?
Spot blast it.
That's right. This looks great through here. Ooh, that's a nice fit. Look at that. These actually, a lot of times on these replacement quarter panels, this trough doesn't line up, but that looks really good. Go ahead and hang your left quarter panel. Once you get it hung on there, get it screwed into place, I'll come out just like I did on the right-hand side and I'll sign off on it. Then you can go ahead and start welding.
Thank you, sir. No problem.
I like the AZ. Thank you, sir. No problem. I like to get more military. Let's get a little bit more military.
You want more
military?
How
about sir, yes, sir?
Sir, yes, sir?
Yeah, I like that. All right. What'd you say? Yeah. Puff your chest out, right?
Yeah.
And click your heels together. Yes, that's what I'm looking for.
I got you covered. I
can at ease.
All right.
That's what I'm talking about. Ha, ha, ha. So we're going to work on our little 1972 Duster 340 car. Cute little car. It's really coming together nicely. I was never a big fan of that particular year of Duster, and I've never been a huge fan of the tawny gold, but it's a really pretty and cute little car. Plus, being a 344 speed now, I know the owner's going to love it. So what I want you to do is to put on as many parts as you feel comfortable doing. I've got to help with the bigger ones, like the grill and the bumper. Alyssa's going to work with me on installing the grill, the headlight doors, the bumper filler, the bumper, and the front side markers. So just a series of things to put together on the car, and that front end will be completely wrapped up. These are our side marker lamps. Intricate things. She's still a little bit like a kid, you know, they want the big sparkly stuff. So going over the mundane things that make a dash work, you can kind of see her check out. The assembly line marking, she's getting better at it, but I think it's a little bit less flashy than this'll be. Putting the beautiful shark's tooth grill in with the bright headlights and the headlight doors. I mean, that's all, I guess I hate to say because it sounds disparaging, but those are shiny objects. And she enjoys looking at shiny objects. So go ahead and put that in there. Press it into place so it's nice and flush, and then just gently run that nut up against it. You don't have to reef it down. As soon as that nut touches, you let go, you're done. So the only thing we gotta do is put our side marker lights in.
Okay.
So you see how there's a square, and a square?
Yep.
Those line up in the actual unit itself. Once it goes in, you give it a quarter of a turn and it arcs. So let me see how that thing works. Got it?
Yep.
Good enough. All right, go plug the other side in real quick. We have the left and the right-hand side markers installed in the Duster. Now we can move on to the very front part of the car, which is the grill, the headlight doors, the filler, and the bumper. So you have this slot here and this slot here. So what we're gonna do is that slot right there is gonna take a special position in this adjuster. The reason we call these adjusters is you have to aim your headlights. Headlights can go all over the place. Now back in these days, it was just a sealed beam bulb. It had these two adjusters up here and a spring that preloaded it. So as you ran it in, it'd point it towards the ceiling. As you backed it out, it'd point it towards the ground. So somebody, if they're blinding you coming down the road, didn't have their headlights adjusted right. We're gonna put that one in there, and then that one slides up into there. And with those two in place, I grab my handy vice grips and I bring it out to here, clamp it, let go, and it is now in position.
Okay.
So the next thing to do is grab a headlight and that ring that we pre-fit onto it.
Okay.
Just
plug those two together. Beautiful. Yep. Good job. Now hold that. Don't let it rest. Set that in there and find. Now, once that's all into place, take the face of it and try to. You can't notice how it's all in the cogs like it's supposed to be. Mm-hmm. That means you're right as rain. So then the last thing to do is to put this on, and you want to just come in. Got it? Mm-hmm. All three are in place.
That one
fell out, right? No worries. We've got the right-hand headlight in. We'll go ahead and put the left one in. Once that's done, we can install the grill. In 1968, Dodge built 1,983 Coronet RT hardtops with a 440 and a 4-speed. This particular one is optioned with a console shift, bucket seats, tick-tock tack, turn signal indicators, bumblebee stripe, and it's painted in the beautiful PP1 bright red. What made this a really cool car for me is its original paint, original engine, and original transmission. I think that in 1968, if you could have gotten a cold air induction Ram Charger hood, that probably would have been optioned on there as well. But that all adds up to why I selected this as our Graveyard Cars Corpse of the Week. We've got the right-hand headlight in. We'll go ahead and put the left one in. Once that's done, we can install the grill. Beautiful. I love those grills. Get that thing in place. Get it centered side to side exactly where it goes. Then the headlight doors or the bezels can go on last. If you look in here, see that square hole?
Yep.
That's designed to have this square unit put into it. Okay. This is a spacer that comes out, and the screw will go into that.
Okay.
So go ahead and push that in there. It just pushes in and snaps. Got to wiggle it a little bit. Perfect. There's one up above it. Perfect. Now go to the other side. The 1971 Plymouth Duster 340 came with the coolest grill on the planet, called the Shark's Tooth. 71, 72 Duster 340s and 71 and 72 Twisters, which came with a lot of really cool options, and the Shark's Tooth grill is one of them. So with the headlight and the headlight retainers in place, we're now ready to put in the legendary grill assembly. You'll see here in the back, you've got the position for your bulbs to go into. Those are already in place and hanging right here.
Okay.
Okay. So go pull the other one out and put it in that same position. Okay. Those are going to go into these right here, mm-hmm. Turn and lock. Then this is the bottom of the grill. We got these. And go ahead and put your lights in. They'll only go one way. So now we're just going to go up, locate that first hole, go in with the bottom first. None of the things that we do in this shop are above Alyssa's ability someday. So if she builds her foundation based on what I and the other guys are trying to teach her here, I have no doubt that once I shuffle from this mortar coil, Alyssa would be able to run this place just fine. So we want to make sure we're down in all of our tabs. Looks nice. So then this is going to roll straight in. And it's got to go up over the top of that ledge. So that one's got to go over that ledge. There you go. Nice, nice.
That one in nicely. Okay.
I'll hold it in place for you. And this pushes in there. Sometimes they're tougher than others. Yeah, there we go. Okay, last one here. Beautiful. Yeah. So go ahead and set that screw in there. That's the one that's like a bolt. Is that started?
Yep.
Okay, good. All right. You're going to want your Phillips screwdriver. All right, my ghoulish friends, it's time for a little graveyard trivia. Earlier, we introduced a 68 Dodge Coronet RT, two-door hardtop, 440, four-speed car. We learned that its numbers matching. We also learned something else. How many 440 four-speed 68 Coronets were built with a two-door hardtop? Was it 1983, 1973, or 1963? The answer coming up after the break. All right, my fellow ghouls, how did you do on this week's trivia question? How many 1968 Coronet two-door hardtop 444 speeds were built? If you answered 1983, you were right. It also means you probably paid attention when I introduced the car earlier. Now, 1963, if you'd said that, was 1 year after I was born, brought into this world. I was already reading by that time. 1973, I was 11 years old and had my first paper route where I met Royal Yoakum. And he quickly quit his paper route, so I have my paper route and his paper route. But if you're looking for how many 68 Cornette RT two-door hardtop 444 speeds were built, you're gonna have to stick with 1983. So.
So in typical Mark fashion, I come back from lunch and he has actually taken the time to remove all the stuff I was painting from inside the booth, outside the booth, and there's a rear end in there. There's no notes, I'm not sure what exactly he wants done. So at this point, I'm just gonna spray it black and get it back to him. Every rear end goes black, but a nice heads up would be good from time to time, or just don't move my So at this point, I'll just paint it and be done. In years past, Mark has been great at interrupting and disrupting the flow out here. Recently, it hasn't been too bad, so I can deal with this as long as it's not an everyday routine. So if I don't shoot this rear end right now, then he's gonna come out and be like, hey, why didn't you do it? They all go black. So just easiest to go in there and get it painted black.
Good, can I get that now? The rear end. Well,
it's
I
wet.
Need it.
Well, it's wet.
So. Well, can't you broil it or something? Broil it? Bake it?
Yes, I can bake it.
Uh-huh.
Do you want me to bake it?
Yes. Hurry. I need it right away.
Do you see what I'm doing here?
What are you doing?
We're filming right now.
You are?
Yeah.
Oh, no. Okay.
All the rear ends, Cousin Dougie takes them, sandblasts them, does a really good job at prepping them. He really does great. So, you know, when you go in there, it's bare metal. So the only thing you really have to do is put a coat of DP90 on it, and that way the paint will stick to that. The black is all done in a single stage. It does take 4 to 5 hours before I can pull it out of the booth. And before they can handle it, it's actually gonna be the next day.
The next evolution of graveyard cars is gonna be Graveyard Dreams. That's gonna be what we've been talking about, where you can call me up and order anything you want. That's what Jim did with the 72 Duster. Find me a car and make it look like the Monroney that I have from my original car. So I want Alyssa to have her hands on this, have the experience, have a little bit of sweat, blood, and tears on this car. So when Jim comes out and gets it, it'll mean more to her. You wanna put the brackets on the bumper, which is what we've done here, okay? But you wanna leave these loose. There's a little bit of adjustment in these.
Okay.
So leave them loose enough that those things will just slide really easy. And then once it's in position, we center it side to side and we can go ahead and tighten it down.
Okay.
Let's roll it up and see if it goes up like it should. It does, okay. Grab your other bolt. Kind of set it where you think it might go. So right here, this gap, you see my finger?
Mm-hmm.
So now we're gonna check it against the other side. That's the easiest way to tell. And that is just exactly where we wanna be. Okay, if you can go up a hair, just a hair, right there. We've got two more things to do here. Hold it good with your other hand so it can't slip off. If it hits anything, it hits your hand. You can grow a new hand. I can't get a new license plate.
Okay. Boom.
All right. Looks good. The only part I have left is I want to put the emblem on the hood. I worked on this car. I watched it go through the shop. So to be able to put it on, it's just like your signature at the bottom of the page. See these barrel clips?
Uh-huh.
They're already in place. These are designed to be put on from the outside. Now, a lot of butcher shops, they don't know what barrel clips are, so they don't even put them in. They'll just go through the back, drill a hole for an access to put a speed nut on the back. We do it the way the factory did. So, we line this little bad boy up here. This thing lines up perfectly in there, okay? And then it's just a matter of pressing it down into each one of the holes. Is that beautiful or is that beautiful?
All right, looks pretty good.
Looks nice, doesn't it?
Yes.
It's all the way down, nice and flush. It's gold. You can have a little stamp put together, dip it in some ink, and give it a hammer on the backside and put it in the bank. It's 1975, you're looking to buy a used car. Muscle car era is gone. The motto race on Sunday, sell on Monday, that's gone. The cars are all but forgotten, really. They're still on the streets, but most people are thinking of gas mileage, because gas was expensive. So the question is, if it was you and it was 1975, which car would you want to go cruising around with your friends and your family in? Would it be a 69 Charger, 318 automatic air conditioning, power steering, power brakes? Or are you still holding on to the past and you want a 69 GTX, 426 Hemi, 4-speed manual steering and manual brakes? Go to graveyardcars.com to cast your vote, and next week live on Facebook, we'll announce what you chose.
So far, Will knocked out the primer on the Charger Daytona right before Mark took over the booth and pushed the Duster's rear end ahead of the line. Mark checked off George's metalwork on the 69 Cuda and instructed him on the finer points of a proper salute. Still to come, Mark checks in again with George to test his military mettle.
Attention!
Then builds out the Duster's steering column. And with the rear end painted and broiled, the ghouls might have time to install the Duster's drivetrain.
Stands up!
At ease. All right, let's have a look at it. I like that. I like malleable employees. I like that. Well, thank you. This is a real CUDA. The A57 package meant, when it was introduced mid-year, that it went from a Barracuda Formula S, let's say, with a 383 four-speed, over to the actual CUDA model. This was the first time Plymouth called it a CUDA. It's a little bit wide, but by the time we're done doing bodywork, primering, painting it twice, which we do our cars, this gap will look exactly the way it's supposed to. Okay, that looks good. This seam right here, there's areas here, because we didn't replace this panel, this is the original, that it gets a little bit kind of like a potato chip, kind of wavy through there. You'll need to tap that down and get a good flat flush finish before he starts welding on it.
Bad hop!
Okay, Eddie's. Oh, you already had ease.
No, I went as soon as you said it.
Did you had ease before I had ease you?
No.
Don't do that, man. You've got a really nice line right there. This one looks just like the other side. That's a good gap to start with. So I would like to start at the front of the car and get a military sign off.
Attention! Calcut nose installed and welded.
Sir, yes, sir.
Front floor pan cleaned, cut, trimmed and installed.
Sir, yes, sir.
Rear stepwells left and right, clean, cut, trimmed and installed.
Sir, yes, sir.
Under seat pan, clean, cut, trimmed and installed.
Sir, yes, sir.
Trunk floor pan, clean, cut, trimmed and installed.
Sir, yes, sir.
Right hand quarter.
Sir, yes, sir. It is installed.
At ease. I'm gonna start running this place a little bit more like a military establishment, I think. As you were.
Thank you.
Only two things coming out of Texas. And don't leave that in there, because if you're from Texas, that was... So while everybody's working hard on getting the 72 Duster wrapped up, I'm gonna put the steering column together. Remember, this is a dream car. We bought a car that was a slant six automatic on the column, and we're converting it over to a 340 and a 4-speed for this guy. Here you can see that they're the exact same length, overall length. This one for the automatic on the column, this one for the 71 to 74 B&E body. Now, in 71, to get the key out of the ignition, you had to press this little tab down, but this is what you would have had on that floor-shifted car. The rest of it's very similar. The compelling thing is, this is a three-piece unit that makes up the automatic on the floor or the four-speed on the floor, where this one is a two-piece unit. So when you're doing a conversion on one of these cars, to do it right, you would want these three pieces. The rest of the column is exactly the same. First thing is this little jewel right here. This is the lock. This is the lock that's going to engage with this sprocket. It's gonna go a little something like that, and I'll show you again how it all sets in space. But that is what would lock the column from being able to steer. It's also one of the first pieces that we have to put into our collar. So it goes down in this crevice right here. Our collar, it's gonna line up with the second collar with all these holes. This little spring is very important. It makes this click back into position like it's supposed to. And it's easier now to put it in than after this is in place, especially if you have fat little sausage fingers like mine. So this hole right here goes like that. Feed this around it, around to here. Grab our needle nose pliers, and we'll clip that spring on there from here, just like this. And now, if the key, if you wanted to get the key out, you'd turn it back to here. But until you did this, the key would not come out. Once you did this, once you pull that key out, that'll stay down like that. As soon as you put the key in and go to the first click, it snaps back to there. So with that in place, we can put the intermediate collar in. We'll put this in place. Okay, next thing we're gonna put in is the ignition switch. So, it's a lot easier to do out here on the bench. We can put in the key in buzzer switch. It's gonna go down into this locating hole and this screw hole. I will show you how the key will work. This pin is gonna pop out into that opening. That's what keeps you from being able to walk up this car, jerk this thing out of there, put a pair of pliers down there and run that ignition switch. So all that stuff you see in the movies is all fake. All fake, Meatball. Hear that? Sweet. That thing is now where it belongs. If I take the key, see how it pushes that switch down? That closes the contacts. That tells the car there's a key in the ignition and that buzzer starts going off. You take it back like that, quiet. Okay, so with that in place, I just need to put the retainer on right here that goes over the lock that actually controls the steering wheel lock and this key release mechanism at the back. This small plate right here goes into position like that. That centers that lock so it can't jump around. It holds it in place, but you have to put it on after everything else is in place. Put your key in. Tab goes down, says there's a key in the ignition. Close your door. You don't have any buzzing sound. Watch this lever when I turn to the on position. See how it jumped up there? You go back to get the key out, and you can't get the key out. You have to come all the way back to this to be able to get the key out. To get that key out, you press this down. Now it goes all the way back to the position. You can get your key out. This piece will go on after we put the steering shaft through the column. It'll go on there. Then we'll put the turn signal, the four-way switch, all that's one unit. We can put the steering wheel on it, because I know they're getting ready to put the steering column in it. Once that's done, we can lower that car down, roll it outside, and see if we can get her running. Meeting adjourned. Hello, my ghoulish friends, ghouls and ghoulettes. Time for another trivia question. True or false, 1967 was the first year you could get a cold air induction hood on a Mopar production vehicle. If you think you know the answer, stay tuned after the break. I'll let you know. All right, ghouls, how did you do on that trivia question? Some of it I reveal earlier in the episode. Some of it you have to know your Mopars. Was 1967 the first year for the cold air induction hood on the Mopar production cars? Well, if you answered false, you're correct. In fact, 1969 was the first year for cold air induction hoods. You had your 69.5 Roadrunner, your 69.5 Super B. Those both had fiberglass cold air induction hoods. You also had the introduction of the Ram Charger on the Dodge model cars in 69 and the Air Grabber on all the Plymouths. So, yes, false, congratulations, you got it right. Today, I wanted to talk about the 440 six-pack and the 340 six-pack. Now, of course, if those were Plymouth cars, it'd be the 346 barrel and the 446 barrel. These three two-barrel carburetor setups were available from 1969 and a half all the way through 1971, and there were a few that got out in 1972, very low number. Now, this particular setup, I've already ran the numbers on it. The list number on the front of the carburetor, you see right here, is a 4144. That list number tells you what that carburetor was designed to start life on. In that case, the 4144, it was designed to go on a 1970 440 six barrel or six pack with an automatic transmission and N95, November 95, which means it was an evaporative emission control, a California car. So I'm gonna put my little glasses on here. We'll just take a quick tour around this real quick. Called a six pack or a six barrel because 2, 4, 6. That's the basic gist of it. The outboard two carburetors, they are 500 CFM each, and the center one is 350 CFM. It's the center one that the car runs on most of the time when you're just driving around town. It isn't until you put your foot into it that it opens up these outboard carburetors. So you can imagine when your foot is to the wood, you're moving a lot of air and a lot of fuel through that engine. Over here you see the fuel rail, pretty crude. Just uses these little brass tees that connect the lines that come out of the carburetors together. This has been kind of modified considerably. This is the throttle stud that the throttle cable, which bolts right here, would come up and pull and operate that center carburetor, ultimately the outboards as well. This is the passenger side, and it's the passenger side that has the fuel rail I just talked about. Originally, this should come down here and then loop down into the fuel vapor separator, then go through another piece of hose, and then into the fuel pump. So in general, this is what these look like most of the time when we get them. If you look carefully at it, you'll see that originally these bowls were a yellow chromate. The whole carburetor was a yellow chromate. These screws originally are supposed to be a zinc finish on here. The nickel cadmium that you usually see on the throttle linkage, all gone, all electrolyzed, all rusted. This is typically a six-pack intake manifold that you'd see on a car 50 years old that at one time probably ran pretty darn good, but now needs restored. What I want to do in another segment is take more time and show you the key differences between a Holley replica, thank God they make them, carburetor of the original six-packs, and one that's been completely restored, looking the way it did the day it started life. So stay tuned next time for that. So now I'm in a position where I can hand off the assembly of the steering column to the greenhorn, and I can go back and do the other things that keep this place running. So they're finished with the steering column. It came out beautiful. I'm excited now to see it go in the duster. So we're working on our 1972 Plymouth Duster for our customer on the East Coast who is reliving his childhood by having us build exactly what he bought brand new in 1972, a 340 four-speed 72 Duster in tawny gold over black interior. So one thing I want to point out before they put the rear axle in, this is an actual A-body 8 3/4 rear axle. A lot of A-bodies out there with the little baby 7 1/4 rear end. It's not right if you got a 340 car, not in this year, should be an 8 3/4. So that's what we rounded up. An 8 3/4 rear end housing, a 323 sure grip, got the correct tag on it over here to call out the ratio, and the correct tag to let you know you should use sure grip oil on it. And also, the leaf springs are unique to the 340 as well. So with that, I'm gonna let the guys start putting it in. I've had the drivetrain built out for quite a while now in anticipation of the car getting over. Will did a beautiful job on it, but now it's time to marry the two together. Okay, keep coming. It's about level a little bit more. Let's do it right there.
Yep, looks good.
Okay, come on in, that and in. There we go. I'm gonna put the top one in. Okay, so the front leaf spring hangers are in place and hand tight. So now let's put the rear shackle mount in place.
Right there.
Good.
You gotta do one side at a time.
Can you pull your way?
My way, yeah.
There we go.
Wow. Good?
Yeah.
Here we go. Ready. Here we go, yo. Here we go, yo. I think one of the cool things about this particular build, as is in the case of a few other Graveyard Cars builds, like Mark and Elena's 70 Cuda. Some of these guys had this stuff when they were kids. These are second day things, like you see the Krager wheels. The car left the showroom with regular Mopar wheels on it, the 14-6 rally wheel, and it had these tires on it. Jim couldn't wait to go down and get a set of five-spoke Kragers, and that's what he did, and that's what we're putting back on the car. Once we have the rear end installed in these cars, that gives us enough counterbalance at the back that we can go to the front of it and install the K-member suspension and engine. Remember, it's quite a bit heavier than the rear end, so if we were to put it in first, there's a good chance the car could topple over front ways. But we've got that done in the back, so now it's time to load up the front suspension. George is really getting to be a good technician. He's been here about 4 years now. And when he first started, he was a great welder, but had never worked on cars before. It's been a process of teaching him slowly how to emulate that original look. And this Cuda really is a great example of how much he's grown. It's fun for me, because a lot of these guys are a lot younger than me, so you can kind of look at them like kids or whatever. And George is a great guy, he's got a great heart, but now he's really got great skills and mad skills. If you look at that car right now, look at those spot welds. Walk around it. Look at the cowl cut nose that's put on it. Look at the spot welds where the emulated, where we put the tie bar on. It's absolutely undetectable. Not because you're trying to hide it from anybody. We're filming it and showing you how many panels are getting replaced. We're not ashamed of that, but we're replacing them right, and that's where the pride comes in. So it's fun to watch George grow as an employee, like all of our guys have. So George just came out and got me. The final welding is done on our 69 Cuda. I am here to inspect it, sign it off, make sure it looks the way it's supposed to look. And if it is, then we're able to move it out to the mudroom so they can start smoothing it out. One thing I like to see, look at the spot welds. Look at that Georgie. Matched up nicely against the trunk floor extension. You'll see these are about an inch and a half on center, some cases two. They were kind of all over the map at Mopar. Wheelhouse is beautiful, look at that. 1 inch to 2 inches on center-ish. Beautiful, they were random, these are random. I love how it pulls it in, because when you paint these things, you get primer on them, you get paint on them, and this thing's sitting at a car show, I want to see if it's had a quarter panel put on it, right? That's my job. If this is too smooth through here, somebody's been there with filler and they've smoothed it out, meaning it never looked good before. But if it has these factory dimples from spot welding, it looks like the quarter's never been replaced. Same thing up here, we've got our pinch weld. This is where the outer rocker meets the quarter panel. Inch and a half to 2 inches on center with the spot welds. When those clean up, they'll look beautiful. Oh, look at that. Good job. This is the front leaf spring perch mounting area, or leaf spring hanger area. You were able to do spot welds on that too. So you just came in on both sides?
Yep.
Really nice. Really good job. George, I give you a lot of crap. Stand up. Doing good job, man.
Thank you, sir.
Getting there, you know? Beautiful. So I want to let it down and take a look at the top side, but otherwise it looks fantastic to me. So now I just want to make sure that you duplicated the other side, which you have done. Look at that. Beautiful. Get you going to town, you little tiger, you. Let's see how our lid fits, if it moved. Beautiful. Looks awesome. Yeah, they can make that line really nice now. Okay, and you got your MIG welding up here. Remember, before we panel bond, I want to sandblast all this. I don't want any oils, gases, dirt, anything in there. I want that panel bond to be over bare metal, beautiful, new, clean bare metal.
No problem.
Okay. Beautiful. Same thing here. This is another seam. This will get sandblasted and then get panel bond adhesive. So this gap right here is great. So if I was you at this point, I would put your name, sign your name on the back of the check, put the account number, and deposit it. Because that's money in the bank.
That's what I like to hear.
Money in the bank, baby doll. All right, good job, George. Hey,
thank you, boss.
You're the man. You are going to the show, Carter. You are going to the show.
But I'm really going to the show, right?
Oh, yeah. So the guys are getting ready to install the engine, transmission, and the duster. A couple things that we had a little trouble coming up with, I wanted to point out. Thermal quad. Now, 71 was the first year for the thermal quad on the small block. This is 72. Scott up at Harms was able to come up with one of these and rebuilt it. Usually, these plastic housings in the middle are broken and they're not good. He found one that's date-coded correct for a 72 Duster, well, 72 340 with a 4-speed. Beautiful job. If you look at that, all the plating is just like we expect on our ABS carburetors, our regular carters, except he did it on the thermal quad. Jamie over at Pass and Performance just have fallen in love with that guy from the day we started working with him. I called him up, said I got a 72 Duster. It's a non-numbers car. It's a tribute car, but I'd like to have a 72 A-body 4-speed. He hooked me up, gave us a restored Hurst shifter box and brand new linkage rods for it. One of the last things you may want to recognize here is the corporate blue. Now, we've talked about it in the past. This car is a 72. Corporate blue was the correct color. If you had a 71 mid-year early, it would be Hemi orange. But later 71s and past that, 72 34s, they were the corporate blue. We've already ran this engine, so that's why all the paint is burned off of the exhaust manifolds, except just a little bit up near the heads. So we already know we don't have any leaks, squeaks, rattles, anything weird. So with that, we're truly ready to install it in the car. Ghoul one, ghoul two, let's do it.
Yeah.
Okay. We're putting the little 340 in it. So there's a lot of room in there. It's much easier to install that than it was to install a big block or a Hemi in one of the E or the B bodies. Okay, here we go.
I've got about 2-3 inches.
Okay, I'm gonna come your way just a little bit. There.
That's part of the job, isn't it?
Hold it, hold it. Needs to go
back.
Back, right, and right there.
Right there, yep, right there's it. You got to be able to work inside that car to put the dash and the seats and the door trim panels, put the glass back in it. A lot of things you have to have it off that lift for. So that's sometimes why we will install a drivetrain a little sooner than later, especially if we're waiting on parts for whatever reason. But now that it is all in, we can roll it forward and start doing the final assembly. Okay, fantastic week. We did really well. Will got the primer work done on the Daytona. It's gonna be an absolutely stunning, stunning car. Now, I had to get a little strict with George down in the metal shop, but he came through. There are all kinds of little tweaks, twists, clips, trims that you have to do to make sure that they fit as good as they possibly can before you even begin welding. So that car now finally gets to move forward over to the metal shop. Now, when it comes to painting the rear end, Will did a great job, but I have learned with that guy, the only way to get something if you're in a hurry is just push. Because he's always tomorrow, tomorrow. Well, do you remember what Apollo Creed said to Rocky in Rocky III? There is no tomorrow. There isn't. So the only way to get anything out of him is just to force it down his throat. He took care of it, he got it painted. Doug was able to get it completely assembled. That allowed all of us to round up the drivetrain and work together as a team to get it installed. This was the first 340 Duster that we've ever done. So it was fun to be able to put it together, see that corporate blue in there, which is really, really cool accent against the tawny gold. And with any luck, everybody learned a little something on those steering columns. There was a lot of pieces, a lot of things that never get seen, but at least I gave you an insight as to how we do it and what the mentality is behind how we do it. And as always, I'm a proud papa to be able to work with my daughter, who has come so far in the world of Mopar restoration from a few years ago. So we were able to put the grill, the headlight doors, the front bumper assembly, and it's small things like that. And people at home say, oh, well, what is it, 5 minutes? Well, it's 5 minutes to put it on, but it's hours to get everything prepped out and ready to go on. So I'd say overall, that was a phenomenal week.